Welcome all to this Earth Sciences Week 2020. I like to thank Shankar sir for helping us organizing all these Earth Science Week lectures. And I am very happy to introduce Dr. Ajit Vartak will introduce us, Avti sir. He is going to deliver his lecture on minerals because today is the Mineral Day. Earth Science Week is being celebrated world over, and they have decided each day to dedicate each day for a particular thing. So today's day is dedicated for minerals, and we are going to listen to strategic and rare minerals in India from a person who is an authority, was a member of the Uranium Group of Vienna, Shri Avti sir. I'll request now Dr. Ajit Vartak to introduce Avti sir.
It is my pleasure to introduce today's guest speaker, my MSc classmate, Mr. Arvind Avti. Arvind did his master's in geology from Savitribai Phule Pune University in 1978. Then he joined Atomic Minerals Directorate and then Strategic Planning Group of Department of Atomic Energy from 1979 to 2013. He has also worked as a consultant to the Ministry of External Affairs. He has a long experience in uranium exploration, planning and management of planned projects of Department of Atomic Energy, nuclear laws, non-proliferation and export controls. He was a member secretary and member of 11th and 12th five-year plan of Department of Atomic Energy for Industries and Minerals Sector. He was a member of Uranium Group of International Atomic Energy Agency, Vienna, Consultative Group of Nuclear Fuel Cycle Information System of IAEA, and Export Control Working Group, ITER Council, France. He is a recipient of Department of Atomic Energy's Special Contribution Award in 2006. With this small introduction, now I request Arvind to deliver his talk.
Thank you, Ajit, and all the members of this group. I start my presentation now. So I'll be talking mainly on atomic minerals, what are the resources we do have in globally as well as in India, and related nuclear power program in the country. To begin with, I'll tell you some little bit history of the atomic energy in India. It so happened that Dr. Homi Bhabha, after getting his PhD from the Cambridge University in nuclear physics, he was working there in England, and he happened to come to India in 1939 on holidaying. He was to return back to Cambridge, but in the same year in September, Second World War broke. And when it started, then Dr. Bhabha changed his mind of returning back to England, and he joined Institute of Science, IISc, Indian Institute of Science, in 1939. While working there, he found that adequate atmosphere for conducting research in nuclear physics or nuclear sciences, as well as the funding, was not available. So he approached great dial-up for industry in Indian industry, JRD Tata. And he wrote to him what were his concerns. Thereafter, JRD Tata advised him to write a letter to Sir Dorabji Tata Trust. And after he wrote, he told the trust that there is an urgent need to initiate nuclear research in India. And this was, this trust approved his proposal, and they immediately provided funds, and in 1945, Tata Institute of Fundamental Research was created. This was how our atomic energy programs started. Initially, the research was conducted in TIFR for some time. And thereafter, what happened, Dr. Bhabha's passion for science, especially for the nuclear activities and all that, They are quite well known, and he had a very close relation with our first Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru. And while they were discussing on the issues, they found that we need to have the new law for this, and also that we need to set up a special commission to carry out the research. So in 1948, Atomic Energy Act 1948 was enacted, which was subsequently repealed, and new act in 1962 was also enacted. So under that 1948 Act, Atomic Energy Commission was constituted with Dr. Bhabha as the chairperson and Dr. S.S. Bhatnagar, who was the head of CISR at that time, and Dr. Krishnan as the members. Three-member committee was commission was constituted, and their main task was to look for the atomic minerals in the country, because these were the minerals, base minerals which are required, or source minerals which are required for carrying out the research in the country. So this is how in 1949 Atomic Minerals Survey Unit was formed, which was subsequently renamed as Raw Materials Division, and now it is known as AMD. Under the another great doyen of Indian geologist, Dr. D.N. Wadia, he was again very close to our Prime Minister. Actually, I will tell that story a little later. So this AMD was formed to look for the atomic energy mineral program. Initial surveys indicated the limited uranium resources and large thorium resources in the form of monazite. Although they were quite well known, about the monazite resources of India were quite well known, and this was the main base. Our uranium resources were limited. So Dr. Bhabha formulated a program for carrying out the nuclear power program. And this was whole, this thing program was put up into three stages. It is called as a very popularly known as three-stage nuclear power program. Starting was the, this thing, main final, this thing of to how to use this thorium for in the long run of the country, for elevating the life of the people as well as providing electricity to the country. And in order to do that, in 1950, under the Atomic Energy Act, a list of scheduled minerals were notified. They are called, at that time, they were called as scheduled minerals. Under the MMDR Act, they were notified as atomic minerals. Now, before coming to the atomic minerals, I'll just give the background. After setting up of PIFR and AMD, then subsequently 1954, Department of Atomic Energy was established. At the same time, Atomic Energy Establishment, what is called AEET, was set up. Subsequently, it was renamed as BARC, and other units were set up. This is the organizational setup of the Department of Atomic Energy as of date, which constitutes five research organizations. We have got four public sector undertakings, three industrial sectors, and other where the extramural fundings are provided by Department of Atomic Energy. Also, we have got the newly established the Homi Bhabha National Institute, which is a deemed university. Now I'll start atomic minerals. These minerals, atomic minerals, were notified. I am talking the what are the atomic minerals, we'll talk later. But is as required under the law. Under the MMDR Act, that is the Mines and Minerals Development and Regulation Act 1957, we have got list, there are scheduled minerals that under the part one, in schedule one, part B, we have got atomic minerals. They are the uranium minerals, thorium minerals, beryllium minerals, lithium minerals, niobium and tantalum minerals, rare earth group minerals, titanium minerals such as ilmenite, rutile, and leucoxene, and zirconium minerals. They are notified as atomic minerals under MMDR Act. And under Atomic Energy Act, rather than mentioning by mineral name, we have got the different name. Here, they have been notified as a prescribed substances. And these first prescribed substances list or the scheduled minerals list was notified in 1950. Subsequently, were amended or revised a number of times. Latest list is of 2016, which is called as the source and special fissionable and other materials in which mineral related items which are included are uranium, thorium minerals and their associated complexes. Second is beryllium mineral, that is beryllium, niobium, tantalum minerals. They are included as other materials. So put together, atomic minerals under the MMDR Act as well as prescribed substances, they are the controlling factor so far the government of India is concerned. Now, what are those atomic or radioactive minerals? See what happens, all minerals, if elements, if you look at it in the periodic table, we have got 118 elements in the periodic table. Of that, up to 92, they are naturally occurring elements. And thereafter, all are transuranic elements which are artificially produced. So there are some nuclei of some elements are unstable. And when they become unstable, their nuclei disintegrate by emitting radiation in the form of alpha particles, beta particles, and gamma rays. This property or phenomenon of emission is called radioactivity. Process is called radioactive decay, in which while disintegrating, this unstable element changes or transmutates to more stable element. To give you the example, uranium is an unstable element. Uranium-238, which is one of the isotopes, when disintegrates, it goes into various stages of disintegration, and finally it lands up as a stable element, is called the lead. It enters into the lead stage and then it becomes stable. So similarly, other elements are also there. So in periodic table, all elements in the periodic table which are heavier than lead, that is atomic number 82, are radioactive, such as uranium, thorium, radium, radon, etc., including bismuth. So naturally occurring most stable element in the periodic table is lead with atomic number 82. And minerals which contain any of the radioactive elements in their composition are radioactive minerals. So coming to uranium and thorium, all minerals which contain uranium and thorium are radioactive. And these uranium and thorium materials are the source materials and are very, very useful in nuclear industry. Now, what are these uranium and thorium? We'll come to uranium and thorium. Uranium is the heaviest naturally occurring element with atomic number 92. It has got three naturally occurring isotopes. What happens when any naturally occurring uranium you take? In that, you will find uranium-238, uranium-235, and uranium-234, of which two are very important, uranium-238 and 235. Its proportion, if you look at percentage, uranium-238 makes up 99.27% of total uranium, whereas uranium-235 contains only 0.72% of the total bulk, whereas 234 is in only traces. Uranium occurs in two valence states. Normally it is called tetravalent and hexavalent. Hexavalent uranium is, we call it as in uranous state, that is reduced and it is more insoluble, whereas hexavalent uranium, that occurs as a uranyl ion, UO2+2, that is called, and it is oxidized form of tetravalent uranium. It is more soluble and is more mobile. And uranium as such is a lithophile element. It occurs in the upper crust, very essentially in the geologically, and it has got strong affinity for oxygen. It makes a lot of complexes with oxygen. Crustal abundance as such of the uranium is normally 2. Some people put it as 2, some people put at 2.7. It is in the range of 2 to 2.7. Now it is, although its abundance is 2.7, it is very, very ubiquitous element. It occurs practically everywhere, but in low concentration. either in ppm level or in ppb levels. You take even the water, any water you take, uranium content will be there. Average sea water contains up to 2 to 3 ppb uranium, whereas in soils it will be in the ppm ranges, 2 to 5 ppm ranges in the normal soils. It occurs in variety of geological environments. Practically almost all rocks will have some uranium, right from the basalt or even the gabbro to the granite or any felsic volcanic rocks. Uranium content in the rocks increases from basicity as we go towards the felsic rocks, or as more and more differentiation takes place, uranium gets enriched into those granites or in the pegmatites. So in basic rocks, average uranium content is 1 ppm, whereas in the granites or similar rocks, its average content is 4 ppm. This is the basic, these things, what is we used for our prospecting purposes. Now, above I said here that uranium has got three isotopes, of which 238 and 235. What is 235 and 238? Of these two isotopes, uranium 235, which occurs in just 0.72%, is a fissile material. Fissile material means it undergoes fission with neutron. When the neutron enters into the uranium nucleus of 235, this nucleus fissions and the energy is released after splitting into various fission products. Whereas uranium 238, which has got the 99.27% of the bulk uranium, it cannot be so easily fissioned. So it is called fertile element. That means it has to be converted to fissile material. So how it is done? It can be converted with the neutron to plutonium 239. This is the basic structure what we are using for our second stage of nuclear power program. We'll come to that later. Now coming to thorium. Atomic number of thorium is 92. These are all actinide series elements, starting with actinide, then protactinium, thorium, uranium, like that. It has got 6 naturally occurring isotopes, but most abundant is only thorium-232. Others are very, very in traces, and their half-lives are very short. So practically only one isotope is available, that is thorium-232. And it has got only one oxidation state, that is thorium tetravalent state. It is again lithophile element. It has got affinity for oxygen as it has got for uranium. Its crustal abundance, this thorium is more abundant than uranium. It is nearly 3-4 ratio, you can put it, that it is 3-4 times more than uranium in the crustal. That is 8 ppm is its crustal abundance. It is more abundant. Chemically, it resembles zirconium, hafnium, and some rare earth elements, especially cerium. So if you look at it, that whenever the thorium compounds are there or minerals are there, it is essentially occurring along with rare earth elements because of its affinity for cerium. Similarly, it also occurs with uranium because ionic radius of uranium and ionic radius of thorium are very close to each other. Secondly, both of them have got oxidation state similarity, and both are lithophile elements. Both have got affinity for oxygen. So normally, most of the times, thorium will be associated with rare earth elements as well as uranium. So if you look at the monazite itself, which is one of our minerals, it contains uranium, it contains thorium, it contains rare earth phosphates. Now, thorium is again a fertile element. It cannot be easily converted. It is not a fissile material. So it has to be converted to, I made a mistake here in my slide. It has to be converted to uranium-233, not plutonium-239. There is a small mistake, one can correct it. Later on we can correct it. So thorium can be converted to uranium-233, a fissile material. So how this happens? Fissile material means, as I said, a material which is capable of undergoing fission after capturing neutrons and capable of sustaining nuclear chain reaction. This is also called a special fissionable material in the various documents, especially International Atomic Energy Agency and the Nuclear Suppliers Group. They identify this as a special fissionable material. There are three fissile materials, uranium-235, plutonium-239, and uranium-233, of which only one is naturally occurring. The rest, other two, are artificially produced. That is plutonium-239 and uranium-233. Among the fertile materials, we have got two, uranium-238 and thorium-232. This is the material which is not itself a fissile, but that can be converted into fissile material by irradiation in a reactor. And this is called a source material because it is not a fissile material. It becomes a source for fissile material. So it is called a source material.
हॅलो सरांचा आवाज गेला वाटतं.
सरांचा आवाज गेलाय. सर तुम्ही आउटी सर सॉरी इंटरप्ट करतो, तुम्ही म्यूट झालेला आहात, अनम्यूट करायचंय तुम्हाला. आउटी सर अनम्यूट करायची रिक्वेस्ट केली आहे तुम्हाला.
आलं का आवाज? झालं का शेअर?
नाही अजून.
नाही एक मिनिट.
युरेनियम मिनरल्स येलो कलर.
युरेनियम मिनरल्स करेक्ट. या ओके, वी कम टू युरेनियम मिनरल्स. देर आर मोर देन 200 युरेनियम बेरिंग मिनरल्स व्हिच आर नोन टिल डेट. दीज मिनरल्स, एज आय सेड, युरेनियम मेक्स सो मेनी कॉम्प्लेक्सेस, सो देर आर लार्ज नंबर ऑफ मिनरल्स आर अवेलेबल. दीज मिनरल्स आर नॉर्मली grouped into two categories. One is called primary minerals, second is secondary minerals. Primary minerals means which are formed in the magmatic processes or in the hydrothermal processes. And secondary minerals, the alteration products of the primary minerals, or when the primary mineral goes into solution, subsequently it gets again reprecipitated, then the minerals which form are called secondary minerals. Or we can call epigenetic type of things. So uranium can be found in a number of minerals. That is, I am talking as a secondary minerals, in as oxides, silicates, vanadates, phosphates, and carbonates, various other compounds. It has got the huge this thing, what you call number of complexes it can form. Among the primary minerals, we have got oxides and silicates, and as well as titanates. Among oxide, we have got uraninite and pitchblende. Silicates, that is a cofinite is a silicate, branerite is a uranium titanium, it is uranium titanate, so it containing thorium. Among secondary minerals are very, very colorful and fluorescent. Mixture of limonite and uranium oxides, it is called gemmite, whereas autunite, torborite, these are the phosphates. Vanadates include carnotite. It is carnotite is the potassium uranium vanadate, and hydrated silicates, that is uranophane or hydrated coffeinite also is included sometimes. There are, even though we have got more than 200 minerals, very few of them which can form ore deposits of commercial significance. They are uraninite, pitchblende, carnotite, and branerite. These are the globally you can find majority of the uranium deposits are associated with either with uraninite, pitchblende, carnotite, or branerite. Uraninite is a crystal or crystalline form. It is a major uranium. Its chemical composition is UO2. It usually forms, it occurs as a black, gray, brown crystals and moderately hard, and its specific gravitational density is quite high, in the range of 6 or so. Second is pitchblende. Pitchblende and uraninite are chemically more or less same, whereas pitchblende is more oxidized form of uraninite. So oxygen content in the pitchblende is slightly more, and it occurs as an amorphous, black, soothy form. I've given the slide, in the slide it is shown how the pitchblende looks and how the uraninite looks. This is also one of the primary ore minerals. Then these are the secondary uranium minerals, how they are colorful. This autunite is the calcium uranium phosphate. In Jadugada Hills, if we go for the walk or for survey, if you look at the Jadugada Hills in present day Jharkhand, you will find a lot of autunite encrustations in those hills. That is secondary effect of the alteration of uraninite. Turbornite is a calcium uranium phosphate. Sorry, copper uranium phosphate, turbornite. Carnotite is potassium uranium vanadate. This is carnotite is a major uranium ore mineral in the United States in sandstone type of deposits, as well as in Australia in calcrete. This occurs. Then gammite is, as I said, it is the oxide of limonite and uranium, and uraninite crystals. We come to the global distribution of this uranium. When we come to the global distribution, there are some 52 countries are engaged in uranium exploration all over the world. But if you look at the overall these things, only 12 countries account for more than 90% of uranium resources in the world. Total world uranium resources as of date, updated up to 2018, in the, it is given in the Red Book 2018, stands around 80 lakh tons of uranium and 1.5 lakh ton of uranium in India. These are called identified resources, recoverable. Identified resources means actually in India earlier system we used to call inferred and assured. So these are put together. Whereas when we look at the assured uranium resources, that are put in the RAR category, reasonably assured resources. In the world, they stand at 48 lakhs. In India, 1.5 lakh. Now, global percentage, if you look at it, I've given it. I will not repeat what has been stated, written here. But one thing I tell you, largest uranium occurrences occur in Australia. Australia contains a huge uranium deposits. And there is one single uranium deposit which contains nearly 20 lakh tons of uranium. It is the largest in the world. It single deposit accounts for more than 10% of the world resources. And that was recently discovered. It and uranium is recovered as a byproduct, not as a major product. Major product of that deposit are copper and gold. Other byproduct include platinum group elements rare earth elements in uranium. Such a huge multi-elemental deposit in Australia that is called Olympic Dam uranium deposit. Whereas the richest uranium deposits occur in Canada. Canada is a country which contains world's richest uranium deposit. Average uranium content globally is about 0.05%. That means about if you crush 1 ton of ore, you will get about 0.5 kg or 500 grams of uranium. Just imagine, from 1 ton, you get only 500 grams on an average. If it is 0.1%, about 1 kg. Global average is 0.05 to maximum up to 1 to 2%. Whereas in Canada, majority of the deposits are more than 1 to 2%, and some of them are 25 to 60%. Richest uranium deposit in the world, that is called MacArthur uranium deposit, which contains highest uranium content in that is 65%. That means if I crush 1 ton of ore, I will get 650 kg of uranium from that. Just imagine how much is the deposit rich. So this is the global distribution. In India, Indian deposits are relatively low in uranium content. We'll come to that later. Uranium ores or deposits are grouped, or earlier they were two. There are, at present, there are 15 groups are classified into 15 categories. Earlier, when we used to study the geology and all that, they are called syngenetic deposits, epigenetic deposits, magmatic deposits, structurally controlled deposits, vein type deposits, like that. They were categorized in various things. So for uranium is concerned, initially they were again classified earlier as syngenetic deposits and epigenetic. Syngenetic deposits means deposits which were formed at the time of formation of that rock or sediment. Epigenetic is subsequent removal of uranium going into the solution, precipitating in the different form. That is alteration product, or altered, first alteration went into the solution, went into the uranium ions, made of complexes with different things, and when it entered into the particular depositing sink, there it was precipitated. That is the epigenetic. So they were initially. But of late, in the International Atomic Energy Agency, which is the headquarter for all the atomic energy related in the world, there are a number of meetings every year they hold, and all these deposit types are discussed. And they came to the conclusion, we'll put some such classification based on type of the rocks, based on time-bound characteristic, as well as the structure. So it is a mixed classification was provided. And as of now, 15 categories are devised, of which the ones which I have colored, like sandstone type of uranium deposits, proterozoic unconformity related uranium deposits, polymetallic iron oxide brixia complexes, quartz pebble conglomerates, granite related metamorphic, and carbonate deposits are very, very important. Other deposits are of minor importance. Majority of the uranium comes from these deposits which I have colored here. Now we'll talk about geologically some important three types of deposits I will discuss. There is a reason behind this, because uranium is considered to be it concentrates in a time-bound characteristics. Right from the Earth's formation till date, how the remobilization and uranium concentration takes place in the various episodic events took place and all that. So they have been categorized. Uranium is called, it is a time-bound characteristic. The first and foremost, more important deposit which was formed, which is economically important deposit, that is called the quartz pebble, pyritic quartz pebble conglomerate type of deposit. Pyritic in sin, or pyritiferous quartz pebble conglomerate, or it is also called oligometric conglomerate type of uranium deposits. These conglomerates or these uranium deposits occur in late Archean, early Proterozoic pyritous quartz pebble conglomerates. There is very, very important this thing. They occur in the late Archean, early Proterozoic pyritous conglomerates. they are restricted to fluvial or deltaic basal sediments. What are these conglomerates? Conglomerates are deposited. Very important, this one. They are deposited after the development of an extensive acid crust or the first cretonization of Proterozoic and late Archean, early Proterozoic, extensive cretonization took place. That was brought to this thing as an extensive acid crust. But the deposits which were developed prior to the largely oxidizing atmosphere. As a geologist or as a mineral economist, many of you may be knowing that when Earth was formed, initially up to 500 million years was called the missing period. Data is not available. But from 38 million years onwards up to 2800 million years period, during the early 2800 near the 3000 to 2800 million period, that was the cretonization. Extensive acid crust was developed, cretonization took place, and in which large number of uranium concentration in the form of uraninite or uranothorite or thorianites, they were formed in the granitic as well as pegmatitic crust. But these deposits, the sediments, have to be deposited prior to the oxidizing atmosphere. Oxidizing atmosphere took place around 2200 million years ago. That means prior to 2200 million years ago, there was we call anoxic atmosphere, some people call oxygen deficient atmosphere in the Earth, in which uranium which was available, it could not be oxidized. If uranium gets oxidized from tetravalent to hexavalent, when it goes into the uranyl ion or uranyl complexes, it goes into solution. That did not take place. What happened? Whatever uranium was available in the form of uraninite, uranothorite, or thorianite, that was released mechanically. It was released mechanically and subsequently transported and deposited as a detrital uranium mineral. Like in the present day scenario, in the beach sands or in the riverine basin, when you go and see the ilmenite, monazite, or some other heavy minerals concentrated, or even the gold in the some river beds and all that, it is a detrital occurrence. Similar way, uranium was deposited in the form of detrital grains. And these deposits are older than 2200 years or 2300 years to 2400 million years. That means after that crystallization, first they deposited after the acid crust and prior to this one. In that time zone, all these uranium deposits were developed. They are generally low grade, but very large tonnage deposits are there. Ore minerals occur in them. They are detrital uranium in the form of branerite, uraninite, and monazite. Now, I'll come to type areas. There are two major type areas of this. One is in Ontario area, in Blind River, Ontario area, that in Canada, where the uranium mineral, which is there, that is in the form of branerite, that is uranium, thorium, rare earth, titanite. Whereas in other area, that is in the South Africa, Witwatersrand deposits. Witwatersrand is very, very well known for the gold occurrences. Here the uranium occurs along with the gold. Gold and uranium coexist in the Witwatersrand uranium deposits. Here uranium is extracted as a byproduct, whereas in the Blind River, it was extracted as a primary uranium. In some cases, it was as a byproduct of rarer elements. Grades are in the range of, in South Africa, it is 0.025, whereas in Canada, they are 0.15% U3O8. In India also, we do have this type of environment. It is all IOG basins, iron ore group basins in India, whether it is in Orissa or in Bihar or in Baba Budan belt of Karnataka. We do have similar atmosphere, similar geological environment. We tried it, and I was working in Orissa, where first occurrence of quartz pebble conglomerate, uraniferous and gold bearing quartz pebble conglomerate occurrence was discovered in 1984 by me. But however, after going for the detailed investigation, we could not find any economical deposits in those areas. Similarly, in Baba Budan area also, investigations were carried out. Deposits of very few tonnage, only hundreds of 100 tons or some 200 tons of uranium occurrence, very small deposit was located, not of any economic significance. Next is unconformity related deposit. This is next stage. After oxygenization of the atmosphere, whatever uranium was there was released in the form of solution. And the deposits here are associated or occur at the unconformity contact of the Archean lower Proterozoic crystalline basement and overlying plastic sediments of middle Proterozoic age. That means the lower Proterozoic and Archean became the basement here. And middle Proterozoic sandstones or any palitic sediments, they become overlying sediments. The unconformity contact between the lower Proterozoic Archean basement and middle Proterozoic sediments, that become the main target area for unconformity related uranium deposits. This is structurally controlled essentially along the unconformity. Large number of faults, fractures, shear zones took place along that this thing. And deposits were repeatedly episodic, this thing, solution and deposition, solution and deposition took place, and concentration took place in this over the millions of years. And result was very, very high grade uranium deposits, large tonnage uranium deposits were developed in this geological environment. Again, there are two main areas. One is again Canada and second is Australia. As I said that in Athabasca, here the middle Proterozoic sandstones are Athabasca sandstones in Canada. Just below the Athabasca sandstone, that unconformity is there. And uranium occurs at as well as above the unconformity. Whereas in Pine Creek syncline in the Northern Territory of Australia, another type area for this unconformity related deposit, huge deposits are there. Locations are called at Jabiluka. So these are the deposits and very rich grade, 0.2 to 25% on an average grade uranium occurs in these deposits. It's time bound, I'm telling you. Now, third is a sandstone type of uranium deposits. As a geologist, again, we know that in the Precambrian, after the Precambrian comes the Cambrian, and in the, that is a Phanerozoic zone, that is Paleozoic, Mesozoic, and Tertiary. In this Phanerozoic era, what started was the first continental plant life started. Plant-based organisms started growing. And as they started growing and all that, after Devonian or so, up to Carboniferous they developed, but after that, what happened? The environment became so rich with the reducing environment that whatever uranium was dissolved or released as a labile uranium from the source areas, before entering into the sea, it got precipitated in the channel sediments, especially fluvial sandstones or braided river channels. That's why these sandstones type of deposits, where we get essential sandstones in the continental, this thing, they are either fluvial sandstones or lacustrine sandstones or deltaic, and maximum is up to marginal marine we can go. So where the, all the uranium before going to the sea, it got trapped into these ones because of the what? These reducing agents like organic material, carbonaceous matter, pyrites, were there, they reduced or they trapped uranium and got concentrated into favorable locales in these sandstones. There are, they occur in tabular format. If the sandstone is on both above and lower, below and above, if there is having the impervious zones like the siltstone or shale, then while moving in the front side, it becomes the C-shaped, or we call it as rolls. Uranium rolls are developed, or where it is not there, it occurs in the tabular form. normal uranium minerals are uraninite, coffeinite, or uranium adsorbed on organic matter, because organic matter works as a very good adsorbent, as in case of our India in mahadic sandstones and all that, where we found organic matter is the most important adsorbent in this thing, in carbonatite in the sandstones of United States. Now we start where this uranium occurs and how uranium exploration started in India. Historically, we can see it started in 1950. As I earlier said, as Dr. Bhabha was the dean of Indian nuclear energy, he is the father of Indian nuclear energy program. Similarly, Dr. D.N. Wadia is considered the father of atomic energies program with respect to the mineral business. Dr. D.N. Wadia is a renowned geologist, and everybody, for geologists I did not tell, he is so well respected that there is an institute in his name that is called Himalayan, for others it is a Wadia Institute of Himalayan Geology, most well known in the internationally reputed institute is there. And recently the professor who was working there, Dr. K.S. Wadia, passed away. Sorry to hear that. And to say that about Dr. Wadia, he was geological advisor to the government of India. Many of us, we do not know, in India prior to getting our independence, that was in 1946, there was a provisional government was set up, elected, or that is called interim government. Interim government was formed in, I think, September or July 1946. Its prime minister was Jawaharlal Nehru, and Dr. Wadia was appointed as his advisor, geological advisor, even in 1946. About Jawaharlal Nehru, again, I can tell you one or two words. For our geological friends, Nehru got his BSc from Trinity College as a BSc honors with geology, chemistry, and botany. So let me come to again Dr. Wadia. So Dr. Wadia was a geological advisor to the then government, that is the provisional government. And after independence, he was appointed as a geological advisor to the newly formed unit, that is a rare mineral survey unit, subsequently known as AMD. Till 1969, Dr. Wadia was geological advisor to AMD. So uranium exploration, or the exploration for atomic minerals, started in 1950 after that commission was set up. And first uranium occurrence we got in 1951 in Jadugura. Second was in Umra in Rajasthan, that is in Udaipur district. Jadugura and Umra, the exploratory minings were started in 1957. Umra was closed. However, Jadugura uranium mine was opened in 1967, and even now it is in operation. For nearly more than 40 years, it has been producing uranium from that mine. And after that, up to 1975, main area of concentration for uranium exploration was this one, that is Singhbhum Belt. Here is as written as number 5, Singhbhum Belt. And uranium, this area was established as a uranium province of the country. Second was, at that time, Rajasthan is in Udaipur. Here it is this thing. Now it's still operations are, or other explorations are going on, but Umra was in this area. Then subsequently, after 1975, the new areas were developed, and provinces such as sandstones in Meghalaya. Here is the, sandstones here in Meghalaya. Then Kadapa Basin, in the northern Kadapa Basin as well as southern Kadapa Basin, we have got Proterozoic basins and all that. Uranium has been discovered. Mines have started operating in the southern part. Another, at the base of Bhima Basin, Bhima and Kaladgi Basin, we have been working. And Rajasthan also, Proterozoic basins. So subsequent uranium explorations have established uranium provinces in Mahadik sandstones in Meghalaya, Kadapa Basin, Bhima Basin, and Rajasthan. Now I come to, this is that Singhbhum where I was talking. This is first uranium occurrences, Jadugada and all. So we'll come to this. This is a very important area. So for the geology of the India is concerned, practically for geologists in all the MSA postgraduate as well as research level, more than some 500 research papers have been published in this area only, on whether geology or metallogeny or mineral resources. Or and most important geologists who worked in this are Dr. J.A. Dunn, Dunn and Day. Even now, after the nearly how many years, 60, 70, 80 years of their work, still their books are considered as a Gita or Mahabharata or Ramayana for our geological activities. Anyway, this is the Singhbhum shear zone. Earlier it was called the Singhbhum thrust belt. So it was known as STB. Now it is called the Singhbhum shear zone. Here in the southern part, it is the Archean massif is there, granites, Singhbhum granites. On the northern side, these are metasediments. In the yellow, this thing, they are Chaibasa schists and quartzites are there. And all along this massif, arcuate belt of 160 kilometers, this is the Singhbhum shear zone. It is the green part, is the Dhanjori volcanics are there. And between Dhanjori volcanics and this shear zone, in the grayish part, this is the soda granite was subsequent introduced. This thing. And this particular zone is a target for mineralization. All those put in the red font are the uranium deposits, and other in the black fonts are the copper deposits. This is called the copper uranium belt of the country. Initial copper mines were developed in southern part where the near basic rocks and metabasics are there. This is one of the India's oldest mine was Musabani, Surda and Rakha, Rome Rakha mines were here in that area. Ghatsila was the copper plant was there, processing plant. And now we have got uranium deposits here at the Jadugada, then Bhatin, Narwa Pahad, Turumdi, Bandu Hurang, Mahuldi, and in southern part it is Bagjata. So these seven uranium deposits are being worked out. We have got two processing plants. We'll come next to that. And let me tell you, after doing my post-graduation, when I joined Department of Atomic Energy in the Atomic Minerals Directorate, AMD, my first assignment was in this Bagjata, where the exploratory drilling was going on. I joined here and I learned my geology at this thing in the Singhbhum belt as a professional geologist. Next is Meghalaya. This Meghalaya is very important. This was discovered in the 70s. Meghalaya plateau, if you have a look at it, it looks like the host. On the northern side, it is bounded on four sides. On the northern side, Brahmaputra Graben is there. On the southern side, Dauki Fault is there. Here it is, this is the southern part is the Dauki Fault. All south of this fault is the Bangladesh. The border is very, very, this is India-Bangladesh border. Then on the western side, Yamuna Fault is there. And eastern front, Noga Fault is there. So Meghalaya plateau has been uplifted from all sides. And the upliftment has taken place practically 1500 meters vertical distance between this plateau and the Bangladesh, which is in the plains, about 1500 meters is there. Now, coming to the geological part, southern fringe of Meghalaya, this is southern fringe, this thing what I'm mentioning, southern fringe of Meghalaya has got Cretaceous sandstones. Actually, here we have got Archean basement, then Proterozoic Shillong group sediments, which are lower Proterozoic Thirsat formation and Badapani formation. Thereafter, we have got Mesozoic sediments in the form of Cretaceous Mahadic formation, Jadugutta formation in the lower part, and upper in the tertiary formations. There's a Lungpa formation. Main target for uranium exploration, this yellow part. These are the Cretaceous sandstones. These Cretaceous sandstones are formed into two groups. We call it the Mahadik formation, upper Mahadik and lower Mahadik. Lower Mahadiks are fluvial sandstones, upper Mahadiks are marine sandstones. Uranium is concentrated and occurs in lower fluvial sandstones. And these are the deposits. We have got 4-5 deposits. One is most important is Dumiyaseth is located here. Then Flank D-Line is there. Gomaghat in the southern part. It is very close to Bangladesh border. Then in eastern part, we have got Tirnai uranium deposit. This was the deposit where I was working. During my time, it was discovered. Under my, I was working as a coordinator for the project. And also one more deposit. Here it is a Wahkin deposit. This was also discovered when I was working as coordinator for this one. So these two deposits, when I was working in the Meghalaya, they were discovered. And prior to that, the others. And discovery of, I'll tell very interesting factor about this Wahkin deposit, which contains about nearly 7,000-8,000 tons of uranium. Dumiyaseth is the largest deposit containing more than 10,000 tons uranium at 0.1% uranium oxide as an average grade. In Wahkin deposit, while we were working as a geologist in the exploration and all that, we are looking at aerial photographs. This deposit was discovered using geomorphology and remote sensing as a technology. How is that when we are studying, because this area is very, very remote area. It is not very easy. It is thickly forested, full of gorges. It is very difficult to cross even the small nalas and all that. Very, very difficult. So geologically, when we are studying the remote sensing, the aerial photographs, we found certain textures and morphologies. We identified how it is looking in the Dumiyaseth, in Flank D-Line and other areas. And then while studying, we found some of the areas in this particular Wahkin. Wahkin is the name, it does not have any location. It is a confluence of two rivers, Wablai River and Kinshiang River. So we made it as a Wahkin, as a Wablai and Kinshiang Wahkin. So here, that geomorphological features, which it is slowly dipping the sandstones are there in the form of cuestas or the table land, little low dipping at 5 degrees and all that, cuesta buttes and cuestas. There we found some mound-like structures. Or geomorphology, when we are seeing in the remote sensing technology, we are finding a custard apple, sithabal je apan manto. Sithabal je skin cha textures of some mounds we found. And we observed that similar textures were also seen in Dumiyaseth. So we took the follow-up studies, one of our geologists who had identified those things, he went there on the foot there, after traveling a long distance, he had to camp the river bed. And while studying, we found, yes, what we wanted to see and all that, we found the uranium occurrence there available akin to Dumiyaseth. And subsequent is the story that we found nearly 8,000 tons of uranium oxide in that. This is a very, very interesting story of Wahkin area. This is the, when we see here, Wahkin and all that, here is the thing. This is the Wahkin. This is the confluence of two rivers. This is Dumiyaseth. Tirnai is here. You can see the thickly forested area. These are the cross sections, how the uranium occurs. When we drilled these areas and all that vertical boreholes, how the sandstone, very, very perfect classical style, this type areas. You have the upper marine sandstones, then lower fluviatile sandstones, and then granite as a basement. Very perfect, these things are there. We have all this. Next comes the, this is the outlier of unconformity in the Andhra Pradesh. What I was talking about, the unconformity related uranium minerals. In India, we do have some 14 proterozoic basins, and one of them is the Kadapa basin. This is in the northern Kadapa basin, we have got uranium occurrence at a place called Chitriyal. This is the outlier of Chitriyal. Here you can see lower part here. This is all granite, Archean lower proterozoic granite, and Srisailam sandstones are there. This contact is all mineralized. So contact of granite and proterozoic sediments is mineralized. This one, how it occurs here. Now come to our uranium mining. after exploration, as I said, how much uranium is discovered and all that, our uranium grades are relatively much, much lower in our country. We do have between 0.4% to maximum up to 0.1%. That means if I put it in the terms of kg and grams, we can extract 400 grams to 1 kg after getting crushing of 1 ton of ore. This is the normal thing. So here we have got uranium mining areas. This is the Singhum belt. We have got two processing plants. One is called Jadugada plant. Second is Turumdi plant. Jadugada plant gets uranium from four mines, Jadugada, Bhaddi, Narvapad, and Bagjata. Its processing capacity is 2,500 tons, whereas Turumdi plant's capacity is 3,000 tons of ore per day. It gets the uranium from three mines, Turumdi, Banduhuram, and Mahuldi. This Jadugada has been working for nearly more than 40 years, and other Turumdi was started recently, about 10 years back. And recently, about six, seven years back, this Tumlapalli in the southern part of Kadapa Basin, this mine was started. Here the uranium occurs in dolostone. Till the discovery of Tumlapalli uranium deposit, globally, nowhere such type of, this is a unique deposit in the world. That means it occurs in the carbonate. Normally uranium does not occur in the carbonate deposit because carbonate is a one material which easily dissolves uranium and it keeps it in solution form. However, here in Tumlapalli, it is a dolostone, calcium magnesium carbonate, where uranium has been locked up in the microcrystalline form. So this is the deposit at present we are working in the mines. Other mines have been planned. One is Lambapur. Second is Gogi. We have got the exploratory mine is there. It is also planned. And next mine is proposed is in Rohil Ghateshwari area in the Rajasthan. So this is the present status of uranium mines. One more is mine, the Domiyaseth uranium mine that we call KPM mine in the Meghalaya and Wakin. These two areas will also be taken up for mining in the near future. How the uranium mines and all that? Just a photographs of the mines. Underground mines are there and all that. This is the shaft in Jadugada and all that. This is open cast. Banduhuram is worked as open cast mine. And others are underground mines. This is the Tumlapalli uranium mine. This is underground, this thing. Here's the facilities, processing facility. And the final product, what we get from the Uranium Corporation of India is yellow cake. We call it as yellow cake. Actually, it is called MDU, magnesium diuranate. Subsequently, when we process this yellow cake, we get uranium oxide pellets. This is one of the slides I'm showing when I visited this Canada. This is the richest uranium mine in the world. This is MacArthur uranium deposit, underground sections where I had visited. This is the mining areas and all that. And second area, this photograph I have taken from the aircraft because we had a chartered flight and all that flying at very low, right? So I could take the photograph of this one. This is the Cigar Lake uranium mine, which is very, very remotely worked. Very few people can enter into that mine. It is all remote controlled and mined this area, whereas these are the things. And uranium ores are kept. You can see 30%, 27% and all that. Coming to thorium resources. Next is thorium. See, thorium resources in India were known long time back. It is not the new story. First thorium in India, or monazite, was discovered in 1909. A German chemist identified thorium in monazite from India, or the monazite from India. How it happened? During that time, there was a Travancore, princely state was there. And from Travancore, large quantities of this ilmenite and all this coir was exported, coconut coir. That coconut coir used to be exported to Germany. And some people, perhaps it is thought, they used to mix some sand in that coir just to add the weight to this thing so that they can get some profit. In Germany, when this chemist was looking at this sand and all that, where he was in charge of that facility there, godowns and all the coir, he separated this sand and identified it as a monazite. And thereafter, he came to India and asked for the concession, mineral concession, and he started operating in this area. Initially, Germans were operating in Travancore area. Travancore area, all mineral did this thing for monazite. Monazite and ilmenite was exported under the Travancore princely state to Germany during First World War. After the First World War, these Britishers removed these Germans and took charge of this monazite facilities along with, in consultation with Travancore king. There was a Diwan in Travancore king. He was very ambitious. After the Second World War, when the 1945, these two bombs were detonated in Japan, this person, this Diwan, tried to convince the king that we will not join India. So what we'll do is, we will also produce uranium from this monazite. And if you can get uranium bomb from this one, we can become a very powerful country in the world as others, as far as the concept. Anyway, that was just my point coming back to the monazite. Monazite was known in the country since those days. And how it happened? During 19, when the this provisional government was set up under Jawaharlal Nehru, Jawaharlal Nehru asked Dr. Bhatnagar and Dr. Bhabha in 1946 to go to Travancore, examine what are the things, how the things, because there was plenty of thorium and this monazite was being exported. So he wanted to know the details. And they went there, they examined, and they provided all the inputs to Nehru. And thereafter, it was decided that after the independence, first and foremost thing what we have to do is stop export of all these monazites. So first step Nehru took was in 1949, after this Atomic Energy Act was enacted, that under the Atomic Energy Act, primary first form of this thing was stopped all the exports of monazite. And thereafter, Nehru, Dr. Bhabha formulated three-stage nuclear power plant to utilize this thorium for the future power program. Anyway, coming back to the composition of the monazite. Monazite is a rare earth thorium phosphate containing some uranium also. Its rare earth oxides are 55% to 60%, whereas thorium is 8% to 10% in that, and uranium contains about 0.3%. Most important resources of monazite are found as placer deposits in the country, our country, whereas in other parts, it occurs in the vein type, alkaline complexes, carbonatites, metamorphic rocks, etc. Mineral association in India, in the B sand minerals, what we get more along, it is invariably associated with other heavy minerals like ilmenite, rutile, zircon, sillimanite, and garnet. Monazite concentration in B sands varies from place to place, from traces to 4%. In Kerala side, it is much higher, whereas as we go on the east coast, its content is much less. This is the overall our resources as of now. I'll come to only coming to main part. Monazite as of date, we have got 12 million tons of monazite is there, 34 million tons of zircon is there. Theoretically, when we take into consideration of thorium content and uranium content in these monazites, monazites will have about 11 lakh tons of thorium oxide and about 40,000 tons of uranium oxide. But this is theoretical calculation, because majority of thorium and monazite occurs in the B sands, and because large number of settlements are there in Kerala in that area, when you take socio-economic conditions and all that, practically 60% we have to remove from that, and remaining only possibly we can mine. So let us not go by theoretical calculations. These are the occurrences, important occurrences. This is the east coast, this thing occurrences. Here is the west coast, this is the Kerala and this thing. Here is the Chaura, Manuvala Kuruchi, important. Oscom factory is there. And these are the minerals which we recover. That is IREL recovers. Monazite, ilmenite, rutile, sillimanite, garnet, and zircon. In Ratnagiri coast also, we do have some ilmenite. We do not have any other this thing, Ratnagiri, because of its provenance area is the basaltic, so we get ilmenite, but they are not of any economic significance. Now come to the nuclear power program. This I will be just putting in because of the time constraint and all that. I will put in very limited slides. Globally, hello, can I continue? Hello,
sir, you can continue, sir, no problem.
Achha, I thought somebody was talking. I thought whether any.
Yeah, no, somebody was accidentally unmuted himself.
Okay.
So I have muted him. Okay.
Okay, no issue. Good. So when you look at the distribution of the nuclear power plants in the world, large number of nuclear power plants are confined to OECD countries. That is in the United States, Canada, and all European countries, and Japan and Korea here, if you look at it. Okay. And whereas in other countries like India and China, they are now present in their way. Globally, we have got as of now 449 nuclear power plants, which are in operation in 31 countries. 391 gigawatt, that is 15% of the electrical share, is shared by the nuclear. Other research reactors and some other power reactors are also there, which are attached to the ships and submarines and all that. And we have got 64 reactors are under, power reactors are under construction in other countries. So look at this one, when you say all developed countries have got uranium. Very important slide, I'll come to this thing, how the uranium is produced and how this thing is this thing. You see, this is all OECD countries. Nearly two-thirds, 74% of the reactors are in only OECD countries. Coming to uranium requirement and production. World annual uranium requirement as of date is about 62,000 tons of uranium metal. Here I am talking about metal, uranium metal. There are 318 reactors in 18 OECD countries, as I showed you, concentrated in the OECD countries, and in 131 reactors in non-OECD countries. Uranium production. Uranium is produced out of 52 countries which are engaged in uranium exploration. Production is confined or only it is carried out in only 19 countries. And in 19 countries, only 60,000 tons or 61,000 tons of uranium is produced annually, of which these 10 countries account for nearly all uranium. Out of 61,000 tons, 60,000 tons is produced by these 10 countries. That is Kazakhstan, Canada, Australia, Namibia, Niger, Russia, Uzbekistan, China, United States, and Ukraine. And nearly 1,000 tons of uranium is produced in other 9 countries. That means other countries are practically, it is very, very less compared to this one. But here again, one thing, if you look at the countries which I've mentioned with the red colored font, there are 5 countries, Kazakhstan, Australia, Namibia, Niger, and Uzbekistan. These countries do not have any nuclear power plants. They are 100% uranium exporters. That means they are the countries. Here you will not find a single European country, as I showed in the previous slide. Here is not a single country is producing any uranium here in the Europe. But uranium, where from it comes for their reactor, it comes from these. So if you look at, there is a distribution of uranium production, uranium requirement, as well as power plants is not matching with this thing. It does not mean that if I got the nuclear power plants, I have to have the uranium from my own country. I have to have uranium exploration strategy. It is not necessary. So 5 countries are providing more than 60 to 70% of uranium. And only Kazakhstan is providing 24,000, nearly practically 40% of the world uranium is provided by Kazakhstan. This is nuclear fuel cycle. There are 2 types of nuclear fuel cycles. One is called open fuel cycle and second is the closed nuclear fuel cycle. Open, in nuclear open fuel cycle, once through this thing, whatever the uranium is, fuel is used in a reactor, once it produces power, then that whatever unspent material, whatever is there, it is goes as a spent material, and it is put it into the as a waste. This they can they it is considered as a waste. Whereas in the closed nuclear fuel cycle, that unused material, we don't call it as a spent fuel. We are calling unused material. Unused material is again reprocessed, removed from that material, and what is recovered, plutonium and uranium is recovered, and again it is used. So here it is closing that cycle. We are using it as closed nuclear fuel cycle. It starts with uranium exploration. After that, uranium mining takes place. Yellow cake or MDU is sent to fuel fabrication center at Hyderabad in India. After that, fuel pellets are prepared. Fuel bundles are prepared. They are put into the reactor. Once this thing is, after the energy is produced, again it goes for the reprocessing center, reprocessed and all that. This cycle continues. And after that, whatever is left and all that, it goes to the geological disposal site for final disposal. This is the same thing I told. The open fuel cycle, closed fuel cycle, and how they are significant. For us, the country where the uranium is very in the modestly available and all that, we have to use the closed nuclear fuel cycle because we want to use not only this closed, subsequently we want to go for the plutonium and the thorium. So we have no other option, or we have to have that to use thorium as the final product where which has got the huge power potential. This is the three-stage nuclear power program. In the first stage, we have got pressurized heavy water reactors which uses natural uranium as a fuel. After the uranium is used, it is reprocessed and separated depleted uranium and plutonium is taken out. Plutonium is used in the fast breeder reactor in our second fuel cycle, where along with plutonium, uranium-238 is used. Uranium-238, as I in the beginning I said, the uranium-238 can be converted to fissile material that is converted here. Also as a blanket, and thorium blankets are also used here to convert to uranium-233. So this reactor, fast breeder reactor, it produces energy as well as it produces more fissile material in the form of plutonium as well as in the form of uranium-233. That uranium-233 used in the third fuel cycle as a thorium-based reactors here, that along with uranium-233, we can use thorium as well. So it will be the self-sustaining nuclear power plan will go, which has got the huge potential of, as of now, you can say 1,55,000 gigawatt electrical year this thing can be produced. So this will have, and we have got all fuel cycles are associated, and this can be implemented in a sequentially. We cannot jump to nuclear thorium fuel cycle. We cannot jump to this thing. We need to have, from here we produce, first stage we produce enough source material or fissile material for the second one. From second we produce enough source material to start as a seeding material for the third one, and then we start. So this is a long plan. It cannot be implemented immediately. Some people ask why thorium is not immediately started and all that. So these are the things. Coming to our nuclear power program as of date, we have got 22 operating nuclear power plants in various places. Total installed capacity is 6,780 megawatt. There are two units under construction or commissioning, not construction. One is at Kakrapar, which was recently it went into the criticality in May or so. It will be joined to the grid. Then second is prototype fast breeder reactor. It is in advanced stage of commissioning. Then under construction, we have what? Seven nuclear power plants are under construction. Total installed capacity of these are given here. Administrative approval, government has recently given. Initially, in principle, approval was given some years back. Now the government has given administrative approval for 10 units of pressurized heavy water. These are the indigenous power plants. There are two units of VVR type at Kudankudam. installed capacity, and other units which are to be lost or to be planned are 2 units of Austbiter reactors, 1 unit of advanced seawater reactor, thorium-based reactor, and light water reactor with foreign collaboration, another 30,000 or so. So put together, when all these plants will be implemented, finally we'll have nearly 53,000 megawatt electrical installed capacity. These are the locations. Just only one thing I can tell, all these locations are located in this turn, you can see it. And they are much away from the coal base areas. This is the coal, central India, especially near Jharkhand and Bihar. They are coal based areas. Transportation of coal takes lot of financial these things. So uranium is easily transportable. It requires very limited uranium content and all that. So we have got thorium, I mean, nuclear power plants are away, much away from the coal base. Here, how the fuel from MDU, I already talked, this MDU we get from the Uranium Corporation at Hyderabad, because it is converted to uranium oxide pellets, then natural uranium pellets. It goes to the pressurized heavy water reactors as fuel bundles. It is from the indigenous plant. Whatever imported uranium we get, it is in the form of uranium hexafluoride. This is enriched uranium, and the powder and then pellets are formed. It goes to the light water reactors, that is in Tarapur 1 and 2. And then IREL is zircon sand. From zircon sand, it is the, what is final product is tubes are, fuel tubes are produced, in which these uranium pellets are put, and the final, this looks at bundles, fuel bundles, in which the uranium pellets are put there for the final operation. Uranium pellet looks like this. Then this is the final slide. Now looking at the global scenario, we have got uranium export, 52 countries engaged, about 79 or 80 lakh tons of uranium in identified resource categories there. Production, mine-related production in 15 countries. Production is about 61,000 tons of uranium. And nuclear power plant, 642 reactors in 31 countries, 391 gigawatt installed capacity, and uranium required is 62,000 tons annually. So this is the scenario as of this thing. Thank you very much. Hello.
Thank you very much, sir. Yes. It was a very well prepared, and we really got the overview of the nuclear entire energy sector. And thanks a lot, sir. I'll now request, if you want to ask any questions, you can ask in chat mode. I can read out those questions and Auti sir will answer all those questions. Sir, Ameya Kulkarni sir has asked, can you please highlight the points regarding nuclear waste management?
Nuclear waste management, as of date, in the globally, all the whatever is the list, there are three types of wastes: high level waste, middle level waste, medium, and the low level waste. Low level waste are just in the your hand gloves, dresses, and all that, where this thing they are disposed of. Medium level waste also similar way it is processed. But problem comes with regard to the high level waste. As of date, we have been doing research, and there are how to locate that particular location. Some 2-3 candidates, in the sense candidate areas, have been identified where studies are being carried out. Since nuclear waste does not account for the huge quantities and all that, first of all, it has to be cooled down for certain years. Thereafter, it can be put this way. What is done in the present day, after cooling down, this is put into the borosilicic material. It is the glasses, and it is contained for a certain period. And thereafter, it will be disposed of in geological. Geological disposal takes place after the thorough examination, thorough study, and all that. As of now, only one detailed study in the globally it was done, that was in the Yucca Mountains in the United States. till no country has disposed of any nuclear waste. It is all put it into the their sites where the near the sites or away from the sites those materials are kept, unless the any Congress, I mean the US Congress, gives the approval or no, that idea will not be implemented. Similarly, in our country, we have been studying some deep geological sites we are under, we have identified. One experiment, we were doing it at the Kolar mines and some other area in the central India also. Especially the rock type is where we need is a rock where the uniform grain type is there. Leaching of material will not take place. So we are looking for the granites or some such areas where the fine grade granite without any much leaching or some such uniformity is there texturally. That type of experiments are being carried out, but it will take time.
Thank you, sir. Sir, I have got one personal question. I have heard that some foreign countries are using depleted uranium as a shell casing to improve the armor piercing properties of the shell. This depleted uranium.
Depleted uranium it has got a pyrophoric property. Pyrophoric property, it is used in the defense purposes also. We have also read it in the news that in the Middle East war during Iran and Iraq, earlier when it happened and all that, some of such cells were used. Actually, what happens, this pyrophoric property in the sense, it is put it in the, at the front of the, this thing, when it bombards the tanks and all that, it expands, its property to expand, and it makes that tank, whatever is the armor is there, immobile. So it is used for such purposes, as well as depleted uranium is used as the balancing material for various aircrafts also.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, sir. Any questions? Yeah. You can either direct your questions even afterwards, after watching this lecture, because this lecture was a very detailed one and people will have some queries. So you can direct the questions to Auti sir directly, or you can even write to Mishan Devarai. We can connect you to the Auti sir. Sir, Bansod madam had said it's a very nice lecture. Thank you. Shankar sir has said very informative talk. Thanks. There have been a lot of nice comments on lectures.
Yeah,
thank you, sir.
Most welcome.
Thank you for enlightening all of us on this unique aspect. Ajit, I'd like to request you to thank.
Thank you, Arvind. Thank you very much. Very informative. Very nice, and
Arvinda. Very nice. Very nice and informative. And as a geologist, we had a face knowledge of this subject. But in such a detailed way, it was an opportunity today through you. And thanks for this. Very nice.
Yeah.
And secondly, it was very simple language. That was very important. Otherwise, very difficult.
Even a chartered accountant like me understood. Even I can understand. Yes. I'm a layman, but I still could follow.
Everybody understood. Because I tried to make it, especially geological, some of these things are very difficult. But anyway. Yes. Some of them are geologists, so I hope you understood.
No, it was not that much difficult, but very, very simple language.
Yeah,
and
so thank you very much, Arvind, again.
Yeah, thank you.
A lot of trouble for preparing, because I was this thing, you were telling that, I have not given this thing and that thing. So
thanks, Ajit, also.
Fantastic lecture, wonderful lecture. So we hope more again lectures in future also.
Yeah, sure. Most welcome. I'll be there.
Yeah. And Shashank Deshpande sir has said really innovative and informative lecture. Thank you.
Thank you.
Ajit, udhyacha lecture.
So tomorrow we'll be meeting. Tomorrow is actually archaeology day. And tomorrow we'll be meeting at the same time, 6 p.m. And the speaker is very eminent young archaeologist, Dr. Parth Chavan from ISR Mohali. And he will be talking a very interesting subject, that is archaeology meets geology. So he'll be telling how geology plays a very important role in archaeology also. So that will be very interesting for all the geologists as well as archaeologists also. So tomorrow we'll be meeting at 6 p.m.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you everybody for the participation, and we really enjoyed the lecture. Thank you for a very informative lecture, Auti sir. So I'll close the meeting now.